a nationally acclaimed criminal defense attorney, made some time for us today. And in addition to him doing that during the day, or during the day and night, you probably do that 24 hours a day, 24/7, he also is a premier commentator for Headline News, Fox News, MSNBC, numerous channels that he's going to talk to us about. So the Mass Comm students, I really encourage you to participate in this conversation today. And for all of us, we're going to see how our expertise in one area, because we're all interested in one specific perhaps area to start our careers in, how we can transfer that and network that into other areas like commentating in the media and embracing the digital and cable world that we are living in. So that's enough for me right now, but I want to introduce David Schwartz, and thank you, David, for coming today. If you want to just do a brief intro on how long you've been practicing law and when you started making the transition and utilizing networking opportunities to move yourself into the media in such a high profiled way, and about how long that kind of takes in the current marketplace.
Well, thank you for that question. It takes an entire lifetime. It really, you never quite get to where you're going. At every step of the way, you're always reaching for something, and that's what a career is all about. And I feel like, as I look upon all of you here today, I remember the do you remember the debate with President Clinton, George Bush Sr., and then there was Ross Perot, but there was the vice presidential debate, and Ross Perot's vice presidential candidate was a guy by the name of James Stockdale. And when the camera first went in on him, James Stockdale said, "Who am I? What am I doing here?" And that's sort of what I feel like today. And hopefully by the end of this conversation, I can impart some knowledge on you and give you my career path. But my career path is just one way to get forward in life. There are so many different ways. There are so many different angles. And the one constant theme is that you need to keep your eyes open. You need to be constantly engaging with other people. That's how you get ahead. It's not, we live in a real digital world right now. Everyone's, eyes are buried into their iPhones and their iPads, and that's how we communicate these days. But the real way to get ahead is by personal connections. And certainly, I wish I knew that when I was in your position in college and going through everything. I'm sure many of you feel completely lost. I felt completely lost. But one thing that I knew what my strengths were. And I had a good feel at what I was good at and what I was not good at. All right? And we're all good at something, and in my case, I'm just good at a few things, but really bad at everything else. And that's what I tell people all the time. So you gotta take what your strengths are. I knew I wasn't gonna be the kind of lawyer that sat in the back room and did corporate transactions all day, or doing real estate closings, even though I've had experience doing that, because that was part of life is doing things that you don't necessarily wanna do to get to the next level. And when you graduate, no matter what it is you wanna do, you gotta get in the door. You've got to find a way to get in the door. And that takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of tenacity, a lot of, coming out. Like when you started off by saying, those who don't feel comfortable asking a question should put it on an index card. You should feel comfortable asking a question. So we should have a conversation. And you gotta get out of your comfort zone. Everyone's in a comfort zone. Everybody's in it. I'm in it. We all tend to be in it. And in order to get to the next level, you gotta take yourself out from the comfort zone. And you gotta get out there. And you have to plan on being rejected. Rejection's okay. We live in a world sometimes where everybody gets a trophy, right? So it's okay to be rejected. I've been rejected more times than I could even think of. And you have to get used to it. It's almost like training yourself, because we become so emotional, and we become to the point where, you know what, I don't want to try because I don't want to fail, and I don't want to be rejected. And that's not the right way to go. It's not the right way to go. You have to take rejection. You have to take failure. And I've failed at so many things, but if you think about it, to be successful, all you need to do is succeed a couple of times. You could fail 100 times, but if you meet the right person and that person takes a liking to you and they give you the job or they give you that next level that you want to get to, that is the key, is being rejected 100 times and succeeding once. It's a horrible batting average. You'd never make it in the major leagues. But in this game of life and employment and getting to the next level, that is the key. And so I got off the beaten track a little bit, but
okay.
My career path was pretty simple, actually. I went to high school, went to college, went to law school, knew exactly what I wanted to do, and then got myself a job in the Brooklyn DA's office with legendary district attorney Charles Jay Hines in Brooklyn, who I'm very politically involved, which I'll get to. We run a political consulting company and a few other things also, but he's my first boss. He gave me my start. He was the one that put me in the courtroom. And another lesson from the Brooklyn DA's office, it was one of the lower paying jobs you could get coming out of law school. It's not working for a large law firm, and that's something I want to tell you also, is that you need to take the job when you get out. It may not be the best paying job, it may not be what you ultimately want to do, but you need to take the job that'll offer you the most experience. Because when you're young and you're getting out of college, experience is the key, because that's what gives you value. It's not the salary that gives you value coming out of college, it's the experience. That gives you value. And look at the experience I got when I was in the Brooklyn DA's office. I didn't know what I was doing, all right? This was during the high crime era of the mid-90s. So I got into the Brooklyn DA's office in 1993. And we were inundated. We had 2,100 homicides that year, I believe. Now, Brooklyn has gone through a renaissance, and New York City has gone through a renaissance. We have, I think, about 400 homicides every year. So crime has gone way down. But when I was in it, it was really bad, but it was good for me personally because I got a lot of experience.
You bring up a very good point about the whole experience thing and your first job out or an internship opportunity and the way it works in the music business side, and it might be comparable to your side, is the better the company and the more successful the company, the lower the pay was. So when I went over to Arista Records, they weren't looking to pay anything. In fact, it was almost like work here for free. You could go work somewhere else and make some money, but it's not this place. And that was during the heyday of Whitney Houston and Aretha Franklin, and that's what Friends Are For, and Billy Ocean, and they owned the top chart position on every chart in Billboard. And they were untouchable. So, you know what? If it was $6 an hour instead of $10 an hour, it was better to be there than to be somewhere else, because that was my boot camp. And anyone who came out of there at the time went off to be hugely, hugely successful. My intern colleague and friend, Monty Littman, at the time, we were interns together. I was in the music video department and he was in the sales department, and he's the president with his brother at Universal Music today. I mean, those are the stories, and that's, one of many. So I know what you're saying, like, even just all the people you probably got to know through the DA's office, the phone that rang all day long. I mean, those people were contacts that, are invaluable.
100%, Linda. And, I can't even stress that enough. It wasn't just the cases. I had hundreds of cases in my caseload. And I got so much real experience. And then I was trying cases 6 months into the job. I mean, there are people in big firms, right? They never get to try a case. And I was, and this was my dream growing up, that this would be the kind of law that I'd be practicing, that I would be in court. I'd be in front of juries, and I knew I could do it. I knew I could do it, and I could do it really well. But that's just one part of it. And Linda brought up the other part. It was the relationships that I made. And that's something that you need to be cognizant of always, are even the relationships that you have in this room today. There are people sitting in this room today. 20 years from now, you're going to be in one place, and they're going to be in another place, and you're going to need them. And what better time to develop a relationship than when you're in college and you have that history between you and other people, and it's all about you and other people. So certainly when I was in the DA's office, my adversaries were the defense attorneys, right? They were like the enemy, right? I was the prosecutor, then you had the defense attorneys. But you know what? There was something called respect between adversaries. And I feel that while I was in the DA's office, I developed relationships with my adversaries because I respected them. And I feel I built up respect amongst the defense bar as well. So those relationships, even though we were in the courtroom fighting each other, those relationships lasted way beyond the time I got out of the DA's office. And not only with the defense attorneys, but at the time we had 600 prosecutors, just assistant DAs alone. That's how much crime we had in Brooklyn at the time. And of course all the executives in the DA's office. And I maintained relationships with all of them because, you know, first of all, it's from a humanistic standpoint, it's okay to have, it's good to have relationships with your colleagues. It's good to engage in conversation. And I find the biggest problem when I interview people out of college is this whole idea of communication is lost on a lot of people because, and it's not your fault, it's the environment that you were, I was brought up in an environment without smartphones, without even a cell phone. In fact, I remember when I was in the Tulane Business School, they first came out with the fax machine in 1988. I remember we did this marketing presentation about the fax machine. So, I mean, look at how much technology has evolved and how you're lured into this sense of security because of these smartphones. And that's why I keep stressing that for your life, you're gonna need to have these relationships, no matter what the technology is. Because employers, I have to tell you, are lazy, including myself. I don't wanna sit there and go through 1,000 resumes. That I don't have time for it. I just don't have the time. And really, my partner Brad Gerstmann and I, when we make hiring decisions, it's about how we connect with the person. I don't really care what school, what the grades are. Of course, it all goes into the formula, but really it's about how do we connect with that person. And especially with the type of practice that we have, it's a gritty practice. We have a law firm, very gritty, running around at night sometimes, going to jails, going to arraignments at night, and we need people working for us who are gritty, who are willing, and that'll come out in the interview. So you wanna show your potential employer that you're willing, you're ready, willing, and able to go to the ends of the earth to enhance the cause. Because it's all about the cause. Whatever business you're going into, whether it's the music business, criminal law, or anything else.
Well, you bring up a good point about, and you hear the hot topic, about the fit, if it's a good fit, if we're a good fit together, if it's clicking, but there's so much truth to that, and, those few minutes you're meeting with someone, especially in the form of an interview, I mean, those are the moments for you to shine, and it's very, very difficult to make a first impression after you made a first impression. You get that one shot, and you have to step out of your comfort zone. Yeah, and you have to be prepared and professional. And what are you looking for? Because I think, again, so much of what you're saying, it isn't really the world we're living in this room most of the time, although we're very familiar with what you do and how, what, and the accomplishments you've had. But any key successful person or any successful company, when they're going through an interview process, whether it's a studio or a major label, you know, everyone's looking for the same thing. You know, and that's why, like, even, you know, on a global setting or a national setting, you know, all the main key players, the Bill Gates and the George Soros, I mean, they all have a certain thing. Books are written about the seven essential keys to success. You could apply them to anything. So, you know, on a smaller scale, when you're in an interview process, outside of someone feeling like it fits into the style of your firm, which is has its own style, what are you looking for? What few things could you say, do this, don't do that? I did this and made a big mistake once on an interview, so I always tell people, make sure you don't do that, or make sure you always follow up with a thank you note. Make sure in the digital age how fast that note should show up. Because back in the old days, like with David and I, everything was phone and mail, you know, U.S. mail. There was no other way to get your, you know, material sent to someone. So if it got there a week later, that would be all right, because mail took a few days and all that, and it was handwritten and all that. But now with technology, a week might feel like, wow, that person's really not interested, or they're moving too slow because we are fast paced and I'm on to like 12 other things right now. I forgot who that person was. Just speak a little bit about that.
That's a key question. First of all, it's getting the interview. That's first thing. And we could talk about ways of doing that, but first I'll address the first part of your question, which was the interview itself, that once you're sitting there. First thing is, you gotta do your homework. You have to engross yourself into this firm that you're interviewing. You have to understand the culture of the firm, and I'm going to give you some drastic examples of what I've seen, and I can't believe it. And this is from lawyers, even lawyers graduating from law school. Part of our business is a lobbying government relations firm. That's an offshoot of my law firm. We have Gotham Government Relations and Communications, and we do lobbying work, government relations work. We have clients, everything from Fortune 500 clients to special needs schools, where we lobby their issues, and it's a state lobbying firm. So that's a good part of what I do besides practicing criminal law. And I have to tell you, people come to interview with our firm, and they say they're passionate about politics. Well, what are we looking for? We're looking for someone that's passionate about politics, that understands state government, that loves it. Either, when it comes to politics, it's a lot like law. Either you love it or you don't, and it's so obvious, the people that love it and those that don't. If you don't love it, you should not be interviewing at a lobbying firm. You're just not going to be successful. If it's not in your blood, if it's not what you're passionate about, it you're not going to do well there, and you're certainly not going to do it well on the interview. I can't even tell you how many people sit in my office, they interview with me, and I'll just look at them and I'll say, well, who's the governor of the state of New York? You know, who's the governor of the state? I'm sure some people in this room aren't interested in politics, and I know we have some students from out of state. You know, you may not know it either, but if you come into my office, you're interviewing with a lobbying firm, government relations, a firm that does state politics. How don't you know that the governor of the state of New York is Andrew Cuomo? And that's just a minimum of what I'm going to expect from you. Okay, do you know who the U.S. senators are? Do you know Chuck Schumer or Kirsten Gillibrand? Do you know those people? But I'm going to want to know that you know the majority leader of the New York State Senate, which is Dean Skelos. I'm going to want to know that you know this. You're interviewing with a firm where we're going to employ you to work on political strategy on how to pass legislation, how to block legislation, and how to enhance the cause of the client. And I feel at Gotham, we certainly have reinvented that. But on the law side, certainly I want to know that you're passionate about criminal law, that this is something that interests you. Is it in your blood like I always felt it was in my blood growing up? You have to have eye contact with the person that you're sitting with. You can't look down. You can't be fidgeting around. You have to try to make that connection. And the more homework you do about the firm, certainly our firms, both our law firm and our lobbying firm, it's an open book. We have websites, we have all our videos on there, and I know this discussion's supposed to, you know, morph into television, so certainly we'll do that. But you know, all the TV appearances, it's all on there. So how do you not do your homework when you interview with a firm? And just getting to that second part, the key is not the interview. It's not sitting there and sending out thousands and thousands of resumes into the cloud somewhere. That's not how you get a job, and that's not how you become successful. Getting a job and becoming successful is about networking. It's about personal connections. That job, that most of the jobs that you're going to get, most of the jobs statistically are gotten, you know, at a cocktail party, at a function, at somewhere. It could be in the supermarket. You just don't know where that connection is that you're going to make. It could be in a bar somewhere. It could be in a restaurant. It could be anywhere where you're connecting with people. That's where your job is going to be coming from. So you need to keep your eyes open. In fact, we do a lot of political events in our firm, and I always tell people that if you're interested in politics, go to political events. Go to, you know, there's some cheap ones, there's some where you don't have to pay anything to be in the room. You need to connect with politicians, you need to connect with their staff. If you just did that for a week, if you were interested in politics, working in state government, working for the governor's office, if you just did that for a week, you'd get a job. I'm convinced of it. There are so many people, if you made a card for yourself and said that, you know, this is who I am, I'm just on a business card, and you went to 10 political functions and not went there, you know, not go there to eat and to drink and to go there with an agenda. To go, and that's what I do as a lobbyist. I go there with an agenda. Because I want to meet everyone in the room. If you just meet every single person in the room, hand out your cards, and that gets back to the initial part of our discussion, getting out of your comfort zone, right? That's not a really comfortable thing to do. I'm sure you'd rather sit with your friends, have a drink, and eat, right? That's a lot more comfortable to do. But this is an example of getting out of your comfort zone, meeting every single person in this room, letting them know who you are, what you're interested in, and even if you knew a few people who are going to be in the room and did your homework, telling them how you could enhance their brand. They always want to know how their company or their brand can be enhanced. And you could tell them how you have the skills to do that. And you know, there's so many ways of doing that. So you would be better spent, you know, getting yourself out there than sending out 1,000 resumes.
Yeah. Well, what's nice about what you're saying too, because, you know, we call it like working the room. And, you know, and when even in a high powered position, when you are at events in the music industry, you are still working the room and you're responsible for working the room. And in my positions, I was responsible for showing up with the head of MTV back in the day when MTV actually played music videos and had long form programming for artists and musicians, and the head of John Sykes, who now runs Clear Channel at VH1. And I was expected to show up. I mean, my job was on the line every day with every new project. Your job is on the line to deliver, and to deliver, 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 and to deliver it timely. So you're always working the room. So this whole new thing that's, you know, been out for the last handful of years about networking in the music industry, it's kind of like, that's how you survive. Like, what do you mean networking? That's what we do when we go to, you know, we have to do these things. But what I love what you're saying about the events, the event part of it, whether it's a charity event, a fundraiser, a lot of those things I'm sure in your world come with big ticket prices. Also in the music industry, I just was invited to something that I think, you know, you have to buy a table and it's 10 grand. You know, that is a lot of money. Each person, if you do it individually, it's a $1,000 contribution. But what I love to tell the students all the time is there's always a way around that. Any event, especially a charity event, will need and want volunteers. And you could be the volunteer. You could be the person, the greeter at the door, one of many that has the guest list, and you're checking people in. There are, you know, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction ceremony was run like that for years. It still is. You could volunteer. You can get involved. And then when you're seeing people in those settings, You know, they probably have an agenda themselves. They're hoping to meet someone. They want to get to that A&R guy. Maybe it's the live performer that they really need to, you know, meet up with their manager and speak to them. Everyone, you know, has an agenda, but you're also in an environment of social. Everyone's there to be social. And that is a great time to connect with someone. You know, I always say that too about the career fair that happens here, or any career fair. When you're in the room with people at a career fair, they're there just to be to get to know you. They're there to give you 10 minutes of their time. It's not like you're trying to trip them up or find them in their office or get them to respond to an email. They're actually there because they're open to meeting new people. And so taking advantage of those events are great opportunities. We talk about Grammy U, which is a, you know, of course, a college-level membership for the Grammy organization that does a ton of stuff with students nationwide, and their biggest chapters in New York. And it's a great way just to start that, whether you're meeting a friend who's a colleague and maybe you're going to collaborate on stuff together, or you're just fun to like show up at these things together with, to what you two become in the future, or you're actually seeing some leaders and people in the industry that you idolize, that are mentors for you. And that's going to happen throughout your whole career. I mean, you know, we were at the New Music Seminar over the summer, which is a great event. It's a three-day event of paneled and lectured discussions during the day and signed and unsigned bands during the night all through Manhattan. And we're listening to the keynote, who was John Sykes of Clear Channel, and I just turned, and you have to wear these really dorky badges at this event, like, you know, they're this big, so everyone could see them. But I looked to my left, and I saw, I could read, that the guy next to me is this man, Kevin Godley. And I just, like, couldn't believe it. And for anyone who doesn't know Kevin Godley, you actually do know Kevin Godley, because back in the 70s, he was, I know, I was there with Donna LaTorre, and, well, he was in the successful pop rock band called 10cc. They had a lot of hits in the 70s, I'm Not in Love, all this stuff. But how he influenced my career in music videos was he did this phenomenal video called Cry, for a song called Cry by Kevin Godley and his partner. They did it together, and it was a breakthrough video before all of the digital capabilities you have now. And in fact, it was so, it won a ton of MTV awards, and it was morphing of faces. And later on, Michael Jackson actually used that concept into one of his videos. So this was Kevin Godley sitting next to me. And I just blurted out to him, you have no idea how you influenced my career and what, you know, by your video Cry. And he looked at me like I was crazy, because he probably thought I was. And then later on, he was talking with an executive from MTV back in the day, who's now running Shazam. And he, this guy David, and David saw me, and he came over and gave me a big hug. And once Kevin saw that, he was like, okay, this woman must be all right. So now I could talk to her. But it was a very interesting situation that even when you think you're at one level, right, even for yourself, you'll go into a room and there'll be people there that have mentored you. There's always, you're always growing in your career, and
100%. And the point, I certainly want to clarify that. You know, a lot of the political stuff we do can be high price tickets. But you brought up the point of volunteerism. Volunteer. I can't even stress to you enough. It may seem to you that, well, how is this helping me? How is this helping me? How is this? I need to make money. I need to pay the rent, I need to eat, I need to do all these things. How is volunteering my time going to help me? And I just want to tell you, number one, it's extremely fulfilling to volunteer your time, especially there's so many great organizations out there that you may be passionate about. If you volunteer your time, you're doing a good thing for society. So that's certainly first and foremost. It should be something that you're passionate about. But the ancillary benefits of volunteering, the people that you get put into a room with, the people that run these organizations, that raise money for organizations, that are involved with the community, those people, that'll propel, volunteering in the right spot could propel your career forward tremendously, because when you volunteer and the person running the organization sees that you're an organized person and that you're able to make things happen, and maybe you're doing fundraising, maybe you're raising money for the organization, or you're just running various events that they may have, I can't even tell you how many jobs have been gotten just from volunteering. So this is, this is something that you should be considering right now, even as you sit here today, is do I have the time to volunteer? Because if I volunteer and I do it locally, I can make those connections and I could do something that I really want to do and help other people. So there's so many volunteer opportunities. I'm sure the college has a whole list of them. So that's something I certainly would consider. But and just getting back to the criminal law side a little bit, after I left the DA's office, I became a criminal defense attorney. So all I was doing was practicing law. I was practicing high volume criminal defense in Brooklyn. And I loved every minute of it. And when I was practicing high volume criminal defense, again, I was in situations where I was meeting all the judges, I was meeting the prosecutors, I was meeting the other lawyers, I was meeting the lawyers on the civil side. And that's how I started trying some civil cases as well, because it's really the same skill set. And then I became politically active. So then you're meeting more people, and you're meeting more people. And that's how I got involved with my partner, Brad Gerstmann. I wanted to slow down the criminal law a little bit. I was actually getting a little burnt out, which you'll find. I was trying a murder case in Staten Island. It was snowing every day, and it was a very tough case. It dealt with an ex-cop who was accused of killing his ex-wife, and it was a 5-week trial. And I just said to myself, and you get to these points in your career as well, where I gotta somehow change this a little bit. So you go through a lot of that too. And that's when I joined another law firm that did lobbying, government relations work. And then my partner Brad and I morphed it out. We have our law firm and our lobbying government relations practice, which I love. I've always loved politics, and I love representing clients in front of the state legislature. So I divide my time between the two, and some people ask, well, how could you divide your time between the two? Because it's the same skill set. It's the same skill set. And that's what you have to look out for in your life. What can I do that has the same skill set? So it's about advocacy for the client. So whether I'm in a courtroom arguing a case, or I'm in the state legislature arguing on behalf of a client, it's the same skill set. It's getting your arguments together. It's being prepared, and being prepared for your adversary, throwing things at you that you need to defend against. So I love doing both, and I'm very happy doing it right now. You meet a lot of interesting people. It's interesting that I'm here today, because I know we want to talk about the TV. I always felt I used to love Court TV. I used to watch. This is when Court TV. Court TV isn't even on anymore. And it's funny because the guy behind the video camera, he worked at Court TV, and that's where we met. And tonight just happens to be our Court TV reunion. So Tim is going, and I'm going as well. So it's funny how it runs full circle. But many of you may not even know or remember Court TV. Court TV was a channel. They used to show trials all day long on Court TV, and it was great because I've always felt that the third branch of government, the judicial branch of government, doesn't get enough play on TV. I mean, certainly the legislature, it's flooded, the cable networks are flooded with the legislature, the executive branch of government, the president on the federal level, certainly the governor on the state level, gets a lot of play on TV. But we have this third branch, the judicial branch of government, the Supreme Court deciding all these important cases. So even to this day, I feel, and I talk to network executives about this all the time, that there are so many important things coming out of the judiciary that aren't being covered on TV on a daily basis. It's a real shame that we should have a channel just dedicated to the Supreme Court, and people would be interested in that. But we had Court TV, and I always felt I should be on Court TV. I always wanted to be on Court TV. I knew, and I couldn't get myself on Court TV, right? This is the thing I was talking about before, being rejected over and over again. Oh, why are we going to? No, we have this person. But I could do it. I could do it better than that person. No. It's okay. We got this person. We don't need you. Here, give me your resume. Give me your thing. But I got on Court TV not because I kept calling people. It's because I met a guy who Tim and I both know, Brian Cohen, who had his start at Court TV. We were introduced. And so Brian and I became friends. I was just at his wedding a couple weeks ago, and he's a terrific guy, and we became great friends. But he gave me my start on Court TV. He finally said, okay, and I wasn't even pushing it with him. It, you know, you have to know how to play these things sometimes too. We became friends, but then he asked me to be on Court TV for the first time. So there was the Catherine Cryer show. Was on Court TV at 5 o'clock. It was a great show. She had legal guests, and so I went on once. I remember I went on. Does everyone know Jeanine Pirro, Judge Pirro? She's got a show on Fox News. She was the former Westchester County District Attorney, and so my first appearance on TV was with Jeanine Pirro and Catherine Cryer on Court TV. You know, I got myself all prepared. I was so prepared. Now I go on TV. I barely know the topic 20 minutes before I go on. But for that first appearance, I remember I got myself so prepared, so psyched up, because I really wanted to do this. And so I did it, and they kept calling me back. And that's how the career, the TV media thing started, was that just that one opportunity. And that opportunity I was looking for years. I really was. Look, I was fine. I was practicing law. I was doing my thing. But I really wanted to be on TV talking about, because I love legal issues. I love cases. I love court. And I love the intellectual discussion that comes from that. So finally I got that started. And then, of course, Brian left Court TV. He went to MSNBC. And all of a sudden I was on MSNBC. That was great. And then when I was on Court TV, it was interesting. We had a lot of sports cases. We had the Jason Williams shooting, and then we had the Kobe Bryant case. Does anyone remember that? Kobe Bryant was accused of, everyone knows who Kobe Bryant is, right? Basketball player, the Lakers. But he was accused of rape. It was a very serious case. It was in Colorado. And so ESPN was all of a sudden ESPN was in the law business, because they had the Jason Williams case and they had the Kobe Bryant case. So, of course, they called over to my friend Brian Cohen, and they said, well, who would you recommend to do this? So Brian recommended me, and all of a sudden, I was on ESPN all the time, commenting on those two cases, because they wanted legal analysis on that. And then from there, I met a million. Once you get in the door, you meet a million other people. So then I met the people at Fox and Friends, and I was on Fox and Friends all the time. I was on Court TV. And then to this day, I'm on Fox News all the time. And then Brian ended up going to a couple of other places, but then he went to the Today Show. So then he started introducing me to everyone at the Today Show. And that's how I did it. That's how I became this lawyer, but also this advocate who's seen on TV a couple times a week. And I love doing it, and it enhances my brand as a lawyer and as somebody who's in the political business. So these were all opportunities. I took advantage of them, and it enhanced my brand and my career, and that's how it happened.
Yeah, that's terrific. And what about, how do the cable channels or the news channels work in terms of competition? Like, do you sign an exclusive with one, or, you know, I think you have a great relationship with Brian, and you probably feel like you owe something to Brian, so he, you know, you probably respect that relationship the most. But if Fox is calling you to commentate and ESPN, do you do both, and you're not upsetting anybody? Or is there, you know, because in the music side of things, sometimes there are conflict of interest that we have to be mindful of.
Yeah, you have to be mindful of it. I have not, I don't want to sign with Fox an exclusive, because then it takes away from my brand. It takes away from the stuff that I do on the Today Show. Right now, I'm mostly doing Today Show, Fox, and I do local stuff for WPIX when they want it, and WABC. But what happens is, when you sign the exclusive, at least in my end of the business, they end up not using you as much, and then you're stuck with them. It's more valuable to me than I'm on the Today Show. Even though the Today Show hits sometimes can be very small, it's in front of 4.5 million people. So 4.5 million people watch the Today Show. So you have to be very careful. Like, I won't do GMA, though. I will not do, I've been offered to do that show, and I won't do Good Morning America, because that would piss off my friends at the Today Show for sure. You know, I'm mindful of it. The only time this has ever come into play was very interesting. I used to do Nancy Grace all the time.
I love Nancy Grace.
Yeah, I like her personally, but I'm not crazy about the show. But I used to do Nancy Grace all the time, and back, you know, years back, she was on Court TV, and then she had her show on Headline News. So, all right, so I got booked to do her Court TV show, and then her Headline News show later that night. But little, you know, this is where the politics comes in. You know, little did I know that the staff at Court TV was sort of at odds with her staff at Headline News. So when I agreed to do the Headline News show, I figured, oh, it's fine, right? It's Nancy Grace. I'm going to do her 3 o'clock show, and then I'll be back on her 8 o'clock show at night. The producer from the Court TV show, she was screaming at me. I mean, yelling. I didn't even know what was going on. I'm like, isn't this the same show? It's Nancy Grace. It's 3 o'clock. And it's, you know, what did I do? But really, I got caught in the middle of her fight with the people at Headline News. So, I mean, look, in life, you fall into a million things. Those are the pitfalls you fall into. And, you know, so you gotta roll with the punches. But you know, something about her nighttime show, it's a very, you know, I love Nancy, but the show is not fair. They'll cut you off. I don't like being cut off. You know, they'll cut your mic off. They'll do all kinds of crazy stuff to you. So
that's the behind the scenes things we as the viewer don't see.
Right.
How that happens.
100%. I loved Court TV, though. You know, it's a shame that we don't have anything really like Court TV, because they used to show cases. They do a little bit on Headline News in the afternoon.
So are you planning on bringing that back? It sounds like you're interested in starting a cable channel.
Yeah, anyone want to start a cable channel with me? Yeah, that's I certainly am pitching that. I mean, that's certainly in the back of my mind. I believe there is room in the marketplace for a 24-hour channel covering the law. And not just cut. And you know what? Court TV didn't necessarily do it right either. You know, they would show cases, they would drag on, but I personally loved the cases, and I loved commenting on the cases. But there are so many exciting things in the law. For example, and I think CNBC is doing a little bit of this, but these cases, Madoff and the white collar cases, you know, the case themselves, the fraud that's involved, it may seem a little boring. Well, what is it? It's just someone stealing money from their company, like Kozlowski. Kozlowski had, he's now in jail for 8 1/3, 25 years in jail. He was the Tyco case. All right, it seemed boring on the face of it, you know, but really the Dennis Kozlowski, anyone know Dennis Kozlowski? Anyone heard of him? He's in jail right now. He worked his way up from nothing and became the head of Tyco, which is one of the largest companies in America. But then he got greedy and he found ways to defraud the company. He basically owned the board of directors, and he found ways to steal money. And it seems boring on the face of it, like, who, you know, so someone's stealing money. But his plotting and his scheming to get to where he got, which got him ultimately convicted and put in jail, it was fascinating. It was the relationships that he made within the company, it was fascinating. So I always felt, you know, these white-collar cases could be covered in such a way where every white-collar case is a fascinating case on how people, you know, whether it's securities fraud or any other type, real estate fraud, there's a lot of title insurance fraud. All these topics seem really boring. They're usually big numbers. And you see a little blip on the screen on some news report, oh, Dennis Kozlowski was convicted. But the cases are fascinating. And if you told the stories correctly, I believe people would watch.
Well, I think you're right about, you know, the packaging to make them interesting. You know, the Weather Channel and the History Channel has done a great job of that. I mean, the Weather Channel, it's not just reporting weather. I mean, they put these specials together about the greatest storm or the most dangerous, and they'll even promo certain weeks of, you know, have a week long. But, you know, then it's packet. It's just not turning on Court TV and seeing what's happening today, right now. What are they covering? But you're packaging things. But, you know, with the volume of channels available and the streaming available, you know, if Honey Boo Boo could be on and be successful, I know you have something there. And, you know, and with the film and video students here too, something you were tapping on, like, you know, your one time was successful on TV and then that time just, you know, grew and grew. And a lot of times with film and video and audio students too, you get that one shot to do a good job and you do a great job, no one's losing your number. You know, they want to work with you, that's the team. When I was shooting a lot of music videos, there were certain directors that would only work with certain producers, and they wanted these three camera guys, and those were the guys, and if they couldn't be there because they were shooting something else, they had like their second tier. But you kind of get word of mouth referral like that over and over. They know you show up, they know your style, they know you work, you know, they know you work on time, they like what you do, they like your artistic approach. But it's getting that one time to establish yourself in a place. And also, so much of it is, you know, organic in that, you know, you're working with a team of people, like you said, with your friend Brian, and someone's career takes off or the show takes off. The next thing you know, you could have a job for the next 10 years. You could have a job for the rest of your life sometimes. I worked with people that worked with Paul McCartney who started working with him when he was in the Beatles. I mean, the people who ran Apple Records when I was working with Capitol, they were the roadies for the Beatles when the Beatles were touring through Europe and England. And they were now the presidents of Apple Records. They grew with them. And even on a smaller scale, people who started with Paul in his solo career. I mean, that is, if you're doing a good job and it's working, you're not getting another job. That is your job. You're going to grow inside that business, just like the guys who work for U2 and so many other big bands. You're working for Jay-Z, you might have a job for the rest of your life, because those are machines and businesses unto themselves around the artist.
Yeah, 100%. And, you know, one thing I want to impress upon you is there are no shortcuts. So getting that first opportunity, you know, it could take 100 rejections. And believe me, I got rejected hundreds of times. But that's the kind of mentality you need to have. So I keep coming back to that. To get the one opportunity, you need to go through multiple rejections. And the key is, don't take it personally. Just keep your head down and keep moving the ball forward. It's like, you know, it's like the way the Giants used to be. It's a football game. You know, good running game. Get 4 yards at a time. You keep pounding away. You keep and accept rejection, because it's going to happen. So that's the first thing. But when you get the opportunity, you got to take advantage of it. And again, there are no shortcuts once you have the opportunity. It's not about being lazy. It's about working really hard. So, and just example, you know, we were the new firm on the block, my lobbying firm, my lobbying government relations firm, which has grown beautifully over the years. But we were the new kids on the block. We knew a lot of people, but we weren't part of. There were some firms out there that were established 30 years, 20 years, and they were doing things to try to undermine us. And they certainly had relationships that we didn't have. But you know what we did? You know what the X factor was? We worked harder than them. They were getting lazy. They were getting tired. We worked harder. So maybe something that it took them to do to make a connection or get something done in a meeting, maybe that would take them 10 minutes and would take us 2 hours. It didn't matter, because we were willing to put the time in because we believed in what we were doing. So you got to believe in what you're doing. You got to work hard. You got to make those opportunities, not worry about rejection. You got to love what you're doing, and you got to always do the right thing for the client or whatever the for me, it's a client, but for you, it may be someone else. It may be a project or whatever. Just put your heart and soul into it. And if you love what you're doing, though, you're not going to care if it takes you 20 hours or 22 hours or 10 hours. It's not going to matter, because you're going to love what you're doing. So those are some very important points I would like you to take away from this conversation.
I just want to add, and if you're not loving what you're doing, you might be loving where you're doing it too, because there's always a lot of work, especially starting up. that you might not be interested in those job responsibilities because your desires are here, you know, you have another vision for yourself, but you might be loving where you are right now. You're in a company that, oh my gosh, this is a dream place for me to show up, or a studio.
That is a great point. And certainly when you're starting off, that's good. I'm going to adjust that a little bit, because you need to love what you're doing. But if you're in a place where, you know, you may not have the job that you want, especially first starting out. So you have this job that you don't necessarily want to do, but you're in the right place, you're with the right people. You got to use the other skills that we talked about, the networking, the meeting people, getting out of your comfort zone, not worried about who you're going to speak to and whether you or not you have a right to speak to a person or not. You have a right to speak to whoever you want, as far as I'm concerned. And so, and no one should ever look down upon you because you're trying to learn, or you're trying to ask questions, or you're trying to get ahead, because that's how you will get ahead within a company. And it's about making those relationships. So that is a huge point, is that the key is getting out of school and getting that first job. But ultimately, you know, being in a path where you're going to love what you're doing. And maybe you're not going to love what you're doing at that exact moment, but you love the fact that it's going to take you somewhere else, and that you're working with this person that you may not have had a chance to work with. So it could either be on a job, and don't forget about the volunteering also. You may be working with someone that works for a company that you want to work for, but yet you're just volunteering with them on a charity, feeding the homeless, or whatever charity it is. You may be working with that person and developing a relationship with them. So that's key.
Great, thank you. I know we're almost at 1 o'clock.
So really?
It went so fast. And I wanna thank everyone for being here. I also wanna, if anybody has questions from the floor, we could do that. Is anybody interested? Sure.
I have a long question. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Okay, my question is, how do you approach an artist or company that unknowingly or knowingly stole your music, song, title, and the repetitive part of your hook?
Tell them, I'm going to sue you for that. I'm going to hire David Schwartz, and we're going to file a complaint. No, but look, that's a very individualized situation. You know, certainly the facts would need to be vetted a little bit more. There's not an exact way to handle that, but certainly if someone stole a song from someone else, that could potentially be actionable depending on what the facts are. So you may want to create a paper trail, you may want to put it in writing and start with a letter, but it would, again, each situation is fact-based. So if you want to talk a little after about this, I'd be happy to. Yes. By the way, I knew you were going to ask a question, because You like when I was talking about the connection, like you made, what's your name?
My name is Bella Jade.
Bella Jade. You made, you know, connection with me right away. I saw you were focused in on that. And I said to myself, this person is probably interested in some of the things that I'm talking about. So,
definitely.
So you made that impression on me. And that's some of the stuff that we talked about in the interview process. What's your question?
Thank you. Has there ever been a case or an instance where you misjudged, or you felt you would go in a different direction career-wise?
Yeah, I mean, look, we misjudge all the time. And that's what I talked about, the various failures. And if you are going down a path and you see it's leading to nowhere, it never leads to nowhere, though. There's always offshoots of that path. You're going down the path, but then there's different roads that you could go down. So the key is acknowledging that you're on the wrong path, and that you need to get yourself on the right path. And that comes back to all the skills that we talked about. The constantly, when you're going down a path, you gotta continue to network. Just because you got that first job, that doesn't mean that you stop the formula. That doesn't mean you stop talking to people and networking with them. You need to constantly do that, because you never know where that next opportunity is gonna be. But I think it's very important to understand when you're going down a path if it's leading to a dead end. Yes.
I have a question.
What's your name?
Nicole.
Hi, Nicole.
So, do you have any tips on how you personally lead yourself to maybe producers or someone that was looking to put you on I guess it's a big opportunity.
Oh, absolutely. So, you know, I think the key is in that situation for someone in this audience, someone like you, is to get in the door. So let's say it was court, well, there's no court TV anymore, but let's say it's Headline News or MSNBC or any of those. The key is, you know, you need to get your resume together, you need to write a statement about how passionate you are about working for the company, you need to know a lot about the company. I'm sure the school does a lot of workshops in that area. But then, you know, you need to get online and you need to study the company. You need to see who's there. You need to see how you can connect with those people. You need to look at your own organization. You need to see, you know, what person, what friend, what contact could put me into contact with somebody. And you need to get with anyone over there on a more personal basis. And certainly the traditional interview process, sending in the resume, doing that, that's, I'm not saying don't do that. That you should be doing that. But then sitting there figuring out other ways on how you could get to that interview, and then certainly once you're at the interview, you know, expressing how passionate you are about the network and how hard you're going to work for them. But how, you know, you want to let them know that you'll be the kind of person that will be there 24/7. It doesn't matter what time of the day it is, when I'm needed, if there's a crisis going on, you can count on me to be one of those people that will be there for 24 hours when a news network needs me, or whatever the angle is. You need to think about that and express that in the interview, and of course being extremely as personable as you can be during the interview process. Thank you. Yes?
My name is Sean.
Hi, Sean.
Hi. I just have a question for you. Have you been networking to get your own television channel to report?
Yes.
And how are you doing that?
So far, I haven't gotten it. But I've had meetings with people at Fox and other places, and I've spoken to other people, and to be honest, I'm so busy during my day, I don't get a chance to devote a lot of time to it. But certainly it's an inner thought of mine that is something that's missing from television, is educating the public on the judicial branch of government, which I feel very passionate about. And certainly one day, I'm hoping that we could accomplish that. I'm still working at it. But I'm only 46, so hopefully I have some time left. Oh, yes.
Sorry. I understand that in the interview process, presentation is everything. When you first started your television series, going on television, and they interviewed you for the spot, the first time you've ever been interviewed for an actual show, what did you give them that told you yes, that gave them a yes for you?
Here's my point. I was never interviewed. I never went through an interview process to be on TV. Never. It was all about the friendships that I made. And then once they decided to put me on, the fact that I did my homework and I knew my stuff, I knew my subject matter, and I guess they liked what I presented, so then I got more and more opportunities. So there was never an interview to do any of these television spots, ever.
So preparation would just be do your homework and know people.
Yeah, you got to do your homework and meet. And look, you have to meet as many people as possible. And that's how you get to know people. But so that was never an interview. In fact, when I worked for another law firm, I wasn't interviewed. It was I had my own law firm. It merged into their law firm. It was too constrictive for me, so I had to get out of there. And that's when I started all this stuff. But the reason why they made me a partner in that law firm was because of networking. We networked. I spoke about my firm and a lot of the cases I was doing. They were looking for a criminal end to their law firm and a political branch. So I was in their minds, I was the perfect fit. So that was the interview. It was over dinners and chance meetings at different events. That's why it's so important to be out there. You never know who you're going to meet. And that changed my career. Even though that didn't last, it changed my career.
Well, that's a great point, because I always like to say this Woody Allen quote, which is, 80% of success is just showing up. And really, you just have to show up. And you could show up to a lot of things and nothing happens, but you know, you could show up to some things and something's happening. And then they start, you know, like you're saying, you'll see people and you'll see them again, and you do have to be sociable, because nobody is going to just start coming up to you or knowing what's inside your head or knowing how talented you might be. You do have to put yourself out there and be sociable, but you need to show up first.
You got to be in it to win it, and that's the bottom line. It's not easy. Again, it's getting out of your comfort zone, and sometimes you just don't want to. There are a lot of times I don't want to get out of my comfort zone. I don't feel like talking to anyone. I don't feel like dealing with it, but I force myself because I know something always good comes of it.
Now, if someone's looking to have you on their channel that isn't familiar with your work, will you send them an air check, or you just send them a digital link to something that you've done? What do you do now, like if NBC or somewhere new for you?
Right.
I'll send them my bio, and I'll send them my YouTube links. Tim, I probably have like 3 YouTube channels now. So I have 3 YouTube channels that have various appearances. Every so often we make a montage. So I'll just send them links to my YouTube videos. There's hundreds of them.
We're going to be wrapping it up soon. So are there any other questions?
And by the way, you know, I keep mentioning Tim. You know, I have a law firm, I have a lobbying firm, but he's our social media expert. Social media does videos, and he does it for our clients. And so that's a connect. You know, that's a marriage too that you wouldn't expect. Somebody whose skill set is social media, video. He used to work at Court TV, he used to edit all the various videos and put together those videos, and that's where we met. But you wouldn't connect that with a lobbying, government relations, and law firm. But, you know, we need him constantly because our clients rely on it, and we do websites for clients, and Tim creates all that. So there's some very interesting marriages that you wouldn't expect in life, and that's another thing to keep in mind.
Well, thank you. Tim, I'm going to just let you know that, you know, you can contact me for interns or freelance positions, because, you know, we work a lot with Ed Mangano's office, and I send over, you know, fabulous film crews from here, and they've done spots for Mangano's office that have aired on television, and, you know, there's an opportunity for the Five Town College students to work with you.
Absolutely.
So networking,
we're always interested in young, passionate talent, people that really want to work hard and enhance the brand. It's all about giving value. It's not about what the company could do for you. It's about what kind of value can I bring to the table.
I think there's one more question.
Okay, what's your name?
Hi, Sierra.
Hi, Sierra.
I just have a question. Is there anyone out there that you were inspired by in the field that you work in, or someone that you want to meet that you haven't met?
That's a great question. I was inspired by so many lawyers and lobbyists along the way. You know, certainly my first boss, Joe Hines, who was the Brooklyn DA for 24 years. He was special prosecutor in the Howard Beach cases. I was following his career and what he's done for the people of Brooklyn, and how he's helped create a renaissance that Brooklyn has never seen in its history. And certainly his crime fighting techniques and the various programs, things that he's done for victims of domestic violence, innovative programs that have been copied all across the country. He's somebody that certainly inspired me, and certainly inspired me to become an assistant DA originally.
Okay, I want to thank David for taking the time out, for being here today. It was great.
Thank you. So much fun. Thank you.
You're welcome back anytime. And I want to thank everybody for showing up today. If you didn't grab lunch, there might be still some lunch in the back. And I also just want to let you know that in October, the CFO of Sony Music will be here, Kevin Kelleher, to speak to us about what's going on at Sony Music and a view